Bueno, buenas tardes. Vamos a ir dando comienzo a este panel. Antes, un aviso a los que necesiten traducción, afuera están los equipos. El canal 4 es portugués, 5 español y 6 inglés. Bien. Bueno, mi nombre es Alfredo Verderosa, soy gerente de servicios en LACNIC. Y este panel le pusimos cómo realizar una transferencia de recursos IPv4 exitosa. Desde hace un tiempo, en distintas instancias de interacción con la comunidad, nos encontramos con preguntas como si las transferencias están permitidas, dónde consigo IPs, cómo es el proceso, si se han realizado muchas, pocas. Y bueno, por eso organizamos el panel con el objetivo de poner a su alcance información relevante sobre lo que está pasando en nuestra región, en otras regiones y también algunas recomendaciones que sirvan de apoyo a quienes están pensando involucrarse en estos procesos. Hoy tenemos invitados que son expertos en el tema. Nos acompañan los responsables de los departamentos de registro de los tres RIRs que hacen transferencias y también representantes de dos organizaciones que trabajan colaborando en intermediar en estas transacciones hace muchos, muchos años. Los voy a presentar ahora. Son John Swirin de ARIN, que es director senior de servicio de registro. Penélope O'Leary, que es director regional de Internet Registry Relation en ADREX. Andrea Chima, gerente de servicio de registro y desarrollo de políticas en RIPE. Nacho Mateo, director comercial de IP Broker. Y George Kuo, director de servicios en APNIC. Una pequeña solicitud antes de comenzar. Vamos a tener todas las presentaciones y dejamos las preguntas para el final. Tenemos separado un tiempo para hacer preguntas a todos los participantes al final, para aprovechar mejor el tiempo. Es recomendable, si tienen dudas durante las presentaciones, las vayan anotando. Bien, antes de comenzar con la ronda de presentaciones de los panelistas, me gustaría invitar a Sergio Rojas, que es especialista del Departamento de Registro en LACNIC, quien nos va a compartir información sobre las transferencias en nuestra región. Adelante, Sergio.
Muchas gracias, Alfredo. Mi nombre es Sergio Rojas, trabajo en el área de servicio de registro de LACNIC. Es el área donde administramos los recursos numéricos de Internet, llámese IPv4, IPv6, sistemas autónomos. La idea de esta presentación es mostrarles un poco en qué punto el manual de políticas hace referencia a las transferencias, un pequeño reporte también de las transferencias ya realizadas hasta el momento y un servicio denominado lista de transferencias. Bien, como mencioné, en el manual de política podemos encontrar todo el proceso de transferencia o lo que habla acerca de transferencias de bloques IPv4 en el punto 2.3.2.18. Y para que una transferencia sea efectiva, tiene que cumplirse ciertas condiciones y existen algunos requisitos, ¿no? Entre los más importantes que podemos mencionar, voy a mostrar solo tres aquí, pero abajo está el link, ustedes pueden descargar la presentación de la página del evento y ahí van a ver más detalles si es que requieren, ¿no? Lo más importante aquí es que las transferencias de bloques IPv4 están permitidas solo dentro de la región de LACNIC. No es posible, si tenemos un bloque disponible, transferir este bloque a una organización fuera de la región, por ejemplo, a Norteamérica o Asia. Y tampoco están permitidas las transferencias de bloques IPv4 de fuera de la región dentro de LACNIC. Eso para que lo tengan en cuenta. Si alguna vez alguien les ofrece un bloque IPv4, tienen que ver de dónde proviene. Otro punto también es que la organización que haya transferido su bloque IPv4 queda inelegible para volver a recibir un bloque IPv4 en el plazo de 12 meses. Si bien estamos en la fase de agotamiento del protocolo IPv4, no es posible ya asignar espacio IPv4 adicional a las organizaciones. Al momento de haberse escrito esta política, todavía estaban permitidas las asignaciones adicionales. Así es que ese requisito quedó ahí, pero para que lo tengan en cuenta. Otro punto importante es que todas las organizaciones que reciban espacio IPv4 de LACNIC por primera vez no podrán realizar la transferencia de ese bloque por al menos un plazo de 3 años, ¿sí? Entonces, si el día de mañana alguien les ofrece un rango, pueden hacer una consulta a juiz por el bloque y va a aparecer la fecha de asignación, o simplemente contactarnos también si es que quieren salir de las dudas. Bien, la transferencia, la política empezó a aplicarse a partir de marzo del 2016. Llevamos casi 2 años y medio aplicando esta política y a la fecha hemos realizado 20 transferencias en total dentro de la región. Eso da un total de 192.512 direcciones IP que llevados a prefijo son un barra 15, un 17, un 18, un 19 y un barra 20. Vamos a ver un poco aquí cómo se movieron esos bloques, esos 192.000 direcciones IP en la región. No voy a explicar o hablar uno por uno, pero esto es muy fácil de leer. Como comenté, la presentación lo pueden descargar de la página del evento. Básicamente aquí indica la cantidad de direcciones transferidas, que son 32.000 direcciones IP que fueron transferidas de un oferente, que sería de Argentina, para Aruba. Así es como leemos esta gráfica. La misma cantidad de Panamá para Argentina. Aquí, por ejemplo, está repetido Curazao y Curazao. Esto porque indica que la transferencia se realizó dentro del mismo país y así sucesivamente, ¿no? Panamá para Colombia transfirió esta cantidad de direcciones IP. Bien. Eso era respecto al reporte, ¿no? Por último, comentar que a partir de este año hemos comenzado a ofrecer un servicio llamado lista de posibles transferencias. Esto debido a que en las visitas a clientes, y como Alfredo comentaba al comienzo, ¿no? Los clientes decían, pero ¿cómo puedo hacer una transferencia? ¿Dónde consigo? ¿Cómo puedo tener un listado de esas organizaciones? Entonces vimos que en otros RIRs han comenzado a ofrecer también este servicio y basado en los pedidos de los clientes, trabajamos en una plataforma y como ya contábamos con la plataforma MILACNIC, quizás los miembros que están aquí estén familiarizados con esa plataforma, las organizaciones pueden postularse a ofrecer espacio IPv4 o postularse como una empresa receptora, como que requieren de direcciones IPv4. El objetivo es justamente poner en contacto a las organizaciones receptoras u oferentes para que lleguen a un acuerdo y en este listado puedan tener un punto de contacto a quien contactar, ¿no? Y llegar a un acuerdo para realizar una transferencia. Bien, además de las organizaciones oferentes y receptoras, en este listado también se pueden encontrar organizaciones intermediarias, o lo que comúnmente conocemos como brokers, ¿sí? Entonces, además de esto, van a encontrar brokers. Es importante mencionar que cuando una organización se postula, pasa por un proceso exhaustivo de análisis, es decir, las listas de organizaciones que podemos encontrar ahí, podemos estar seguras que son reales, que son verídicas, que tienen específicamente el rango que declararon tener, porque pasaron por la ACNIC primeramente. Las organizaciones que pueden, o sea, es decir, el listado de estas organizaciones pueden tener acceso solamente a aquellas organizaciones que se han postulado, es decir, no es pública la lista, deben autenticarse con su usuario y haber pasado por el proceso de postulación, ya sea como oferente, como receptor o como intermediario. Bien, eso es todo de mi parte, así es que muchas gracias.
Bueno, muchas gracias, Sergio. Como verán, a pesar de que llevamos 2 años desde que están habilitadas las transferencias en la región, vamos 20. Vienen creciendo, pero un ritmo bastante moderado. Pero, ¿qué está pasando en otros registros? Vamos a invitar a John Swearing de ARIN, quien nos presentará cómo han evolucionado las transferencias en su región. Adelante, John.
All right. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back from lunch. I hope you all had a good lunch. I'm John Sweeting. I'm the Senior Director of Registration Services for ARIN in the ARIN region. And I'm going to give an update on transfers in the ARIN region. And it's really, I have like 8 slides of statistics to numbers. So we're the numbers people. So I'm going to give you some more numbers. So, transfers are definitely increasing. We kind of took these snapshots from The time that the Aaron free pool ran out. So as you can see, in 2016, there was a little over 1,000. In 2017, that went up to 2,400. And projected for 2018 is 3,200. So there's been significant growth. The needs-based transfers are driving our M&A transfers. What I mean by that is a lot of the legacy space that's being transferred was data was stale and not up to date, and a lot of the companies had gone away, but there was legal successors. So in order to prepare that space for a source transfer, a needs-based transfer, they had to come in and prove to Aaron that they had the rights to those addresses, and they would have to transfer them to an acquisition or a merger transfer to a legal entity that vetted today so they can do that transfer. So it's driving accuracy within the WHOIS database as well as providing needed address space to companies. And there's really no signs of slowdown, as you'll see as we go through the slides. So the specified recipient volume, this is the same projection, but this is in actual IPs. So the increase in transfers doesn't necessarily directly translate to more IP addresses being transferred. And what that kind of says is that, and I can speak to the fact that smaller organizations are entering the market. We're getting more and more of your smaller ISPs that are actually doing transfers of 24s and 23s, when early in the market it was a lot of 16s that were being transferred by the larger companies. So there's, to the fact that there's no signs of slowdown, actually there's more people actually entering the transfer marketplace. And this speaks to that. As you can see, the number of blocks transferred, over 1,000/24s, and then you can see it goes down to where once you get below a /16, down to your /12, /11, /10, you know, single digits down in the /10s that have been getting transferred. So when we get to the, here's the inter-RIR transfer volume. As you can see, IPs going out from Aaron have been almost 15 million, and coming into Aaron, half a million, a little bit over a half a million. So 30 times more space has been transferred out of Aaron. So that would be to either APNIC or RIPE, because those are the only two RIRs with compatible inter-RIR transfer policies today. And the expectation, we expect that this is going to continue since Aaron has the majority of legacy space. Inter-RIR prefix breakdown, as you see, 98% of the prefixes are /16 or smaller. And then there's a few, there's one /10 has been transferred inter-RIR, a couple of 12s, a couple of 14s, but the majority is, 16 or smaller. So one other interesting thing that we found is that transfers are actually a benefit to everyone. They actually even benefit the RIR. In this case, the total number of IP address space that Aaron managed has gone down by 14 million, but the number of Aaron issued addresses, so that would be legacy space that's been transferred to somebody else and has come under contract with Aaron, has increased by 30 million IP. at IPv4 addresses, and that's due primarily to the conversion, as I said, of the legacy space. The 14 million there that we've lost out of our inventory, it's in one of these two guys over there, either George or Andrea. They have those 14 million split up between them in the in their inventories today. So within the current Aaron inventory today, there's, as you can see, as of not today, probably a couple weeks ago when we actually took this information, there's 41.7 equivalent of 41.7/8 of legacy. That compares to 44.7/8 to our ISPs and members, and then another 13.3 million equivalent /8 to end users. And we have a, we still have some reserved and held, returned, revoked, still being routed that we have to clean up and give back out to the waiting list, and we go through that. And we'll have that little pool over there all the time that we pull from and fill our waiting list with. Some of the interesting things on that legacy space, approximately half of that is US DoD controlled. It's considered to be under contract, although it's not directly covered by an RSA for each of those resources, but overall, it's considered to be under contract to an agreement between the DoD and Aaron. So that leaves approximately the equivalent of 20/8s that are available, of legacy space, that are available to Aaron, AP, NIC, and RIPE customers through inter-RIR transfers. So that's where a big majority of your additional inventory can come from if you have an inter-RIR transfer. If you don't, that's just space that you just have no access to. Trying to think if there's anything else to say about that, but I think that says it all. So, in summary, number of transfers are growing every year, and we expect they will continue to grow. My staff, you know, most of, at least all, almost all of my time is taken up with transfers, and it's very hard to travel these days because I have to actually physically sign and approve every transfer that goes through Aaron. It's kind of hard to do from here. I do have a delegate, a manager that works for me that I do delegate to, that she'll sign some, most of them when I'm gone. But for the most part, she's checking with me to see if she should or not. So the overall total volume of transfers is about 2.5/8s per year. Aaron is losing space overall due to the inter-RIR transfers, but we're gaining non-legacy space. More and more space is coming under contract with Aaron due to the fact that once it's transferred, it has to come under contract with us. It's also cleaning up the database because all these older legacy blocks are getting the information updated, and then when they transfer them, of course, the data is updated and kept updated at that point because of they're under contract and they have a fee they have to pay, and they stay in contact with us and take care of all that stuff. Another big point, Aaron has a lot of legacy space. We manage all that. We don't get paid to manage any of that. So, you know, the more inter-RIR transfers we do, the happier we are. I like to give the space over there to George and Andrea to worry about. Takes it off my headache. And also today, legacy space is only available to the Aaron, AP, NIC, and RIPE NCC customers through inter-RIR transfer policies. And that's it for me, Alfredo.
Muchas gracias, John. Es realmente impresionante el volumen de transacciones que manejan. Bueno, ahora Penélope nos va a comentar cómo participa ADREX en estos procesos y el tipo de apoyo que brindan a los interesados en recibir y ofrecer bloques.
Hola, muy buenas tardes. Como les comentaron, mi nombre es Penélope, trabajo directamente en la empresa Adrex. Estamos aquí gustosos de tomar unos minutos con ustedes. Quiero tomar un tiempo muy breve para hacer dos comentarios. Uno, agradecer la invitación directamente al personal del ACNIC por esta oportunidad. Y dos, a todas las personas que tengan alguna duda o quieran hacer alguna cita con nosotros directamente, estamos gustosos de hacerla, ya sea al final de la presentación o también me pueden mandar un texto usando la aplicación de LACNIC. Entonces, por favor, tómenlo en cuenta. Estamos gustosos de escuchar a cada uno de ustedes. Y bueno, ahora sí, volviendo con la presentación. Como les comentaba, formo parte de la empresa Adrex. Nosotros nos manejamos una plataforma para hacer las transferencias de los IPv4. Tenemos haciendo estas transferencias desde 2009 y tenemos el gusto de decir que, bueno, fuimos la primera empezando con este tipo de transferencias. Y bueno, desde entonces hemos visto crecer el número de oportunidades dentro de las regiones. La pregunta principal y sencilla que podemos tomar en cuenta es cómo nosotros hicimos este mercado, el Adrex Marketplace. Básicamente tomamos la base de datos que en su momento lo manejó el DDN NIC y InterNIC en 1997. En ese entonces todas las investigaciones se hacían obviamente manuales, no había mayor proceso ni preguntas, solamente se llenaba una forma, te la hacían llenar, la mandabas de vuelta con tu información, ellos la revisaban nuevamente y te entregaban el bloque directamente sin más preguntas ahora sí. Todos esos bloques los consideramos bloques legales, que es básicamente en lo que nosotros nos enfocamos. Y bueno, tomamos esa base de datos, nosotros la administramos en nuestra propia base de datos y de ahí manejamos el mercado Adrex Marketplace. Bueno, dentro de esa base de datos nosotros tenemos las tres tipos de categorías. La categoría A, que tenemos contemplado que son 42 tipos de bloques, luego le siguen la clase B con aproximadamente más de 11,000 tipos y la clase C cerca de 39,000 bloques aproximadamente. Son en unas cifras en general para que tengan una idea de los números con los que nosotros contamos ahorita en actualidad. Nuestro mercado es literalmente sencillo. Manejamos compradores y vendedores. A ambos los invitamos a formar parte de nuestra plataforma en donde hacemos diferentes procesos para hacer todo este tipo de transferencias. El proceso, les voy a comentar de cada uno, en específico del comprador, cuáles son los procesos, los pasos en general que nosotros les ayudamos a realizar y me voy a pasar después con los compradores. En este proceso de los compradores, manejamos exclusivamente un equipo de investigadores, aproximadamente de 20 están en actualidad en el equipo Adrex y cada uno de ellos hace una investigación exhaustiva. Estas investigaciones conllevan los datos de los propiedades, de la información del dato del bloque, se hace la investigación de este bloque y se lleva a cabo la cadena de custodia, porque en muchos casos estas compañías como son desde 1997, 1993, se pierde el rastro. Entonces nosotros investigamos y llevamos toda esta cadena en papeles formales que adquieran nuevamente la posesión de ese bloque para el titular del bloque. En los atributos que nosotros les proporcionamos del documento a los vendedores son tres características principalmente. El registro específico de estos atributos viene siendo en qué registro está, el nombre del registro, el número de bloque y el tamaño del bloque. Luego viene la característica del uso de ese bloque, que viene siendo si está usado en el BGP, si está en el blacklist, la reputación de ese bloque. Todos esos datos son sumamente importantes para que nosotros determinemos el tipo de estado que el bloque va a estar en nuestro mercado. Y por último, contamos con el control, quién lo mantiene, la organización del nombre y bueno, estos tres datos son sumamente importantes para nosotros y así poderles ayudar a los vendedores con toda la documentación necesaria para poder entrar en el mercado. Ahora, ¿qué viene siendo con los vendedores? Eso ya tiene toda su documentación en orden, en listados. Ahora vamos a ver con los compradores. Los compradores se manejan dentro de tres características. Ellos van a solicitar acceso a nuestro mercado. Nosotros les vamos a proveer un acuerdo en donde este acuerdo no es exclusivo para ellos. No les cuesta nada el formar parte de nuestro mercado y tampoco requieren de un mínimo de compra. Ellos solamente es de lo más simple ese contrato de decir, ¿sabes qué? Vamos a manejar total discreción en toda la información que nosotros sepamos de tu mercado. Y bueno, es así como ellos adquieren acceso a nuestro mercado. Una vez que el comprador adquiere acceso en Adrex Marketplace, el listado que está que les muestro aquí, específicamente los últimos tres grupos que viene siendo el producto que se está ofreciendo, el producto de compra, el acuerdo de compra más el acuerdo de titulares, esos tres documentos se les muestran en un PDF. Cada comprador va a tener ingreso, va a ver esos tres documentos, los puede bajar, más aparte toda la información que nosotros les estamos demostrando ahí para determinar si el bloque que nosotros tenemos en el mercado es el propio y el adecuado que ellos necesitan. Una cuestión muy importante que cada participante tiene en cuenta es que todos estos acuerdos son acuerdos preaprobados. Y esta razón la hacemos porque manejamos, ahora sí que compañías mundialmente, que cada uno necesita tener esta facilidad de tener los acuerdos firmados, revisados por su departamento legal y una vez que los tienen, pueden estar listos para hacer la compra y la oferta de compra, literalmente. Esto facilita el proceso y les comento que hasta ahorita el proceso más rápido que nosotros hemos realizado ha sido de 2 días. Y bueno, básicamente es como nosotros estamos manejando dentro de la plataforma de Adrex. Les vuelvo a reiterar, cualquier pregunta, sugerencia o comentario, por favor, estamos en la total disposición y me hacen llevar sus mensajes para poder llevar una conversación privada. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, Penélope. A continuación, Andrea Chima nos va a presentar sobre las transferencias en RIPE y algunas recomendaciones vinculadas a estos procesos.
Thank you, Alfredo. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Andrea Chima. I'm part of the registration services team at the RIPE NCC. And we have seen that John has shown us some statistics about transfers within the ARIN region, but also inter-RIR transfers. Penelope has shown us the processes at ADREX. I will be focusing more on the transfers within the RIPE region and also bring you through the policy developments that we have had over the last few years and how these have impacted the transfer market. So I'll start with the IPv4 status. So how much IPv4 address space do we still have in the RIPE region? As you can see from this graph, the number of IP addresses is constantly diminishing, but we still have about 7.5 million IPv4 addresses in our pools. Looking at the current usage rates, we believe that we will finish this pool in around May, June 2020. So you may ask yourself, RIPE still has a lot of IP addresses, so I can come and get some how many I need. That is not the case anymore. If we look at our current distribution policy, every local internet registry can receive 1/20205B4 address space from the RIPE NCC. It's about 1,000 IP addresses. New members, existing members, each of them can receive one of those blocks. Not more. So you may need more, but this is what you can get from us. These resources are not transferable for 24 months. And this policy was set in place by the community in order to avoid that people would flip the resources, getting the resources from the RIPE NCC and then resell them again. So what if a /22 is not enough for you? For some organizations, it's enough. They are working on deploying IPv6. They need a bit of IPv4. /22 is what they need. But for many organizations, that is not enough. So, and this is reflected in our transfer statistics. These are the numbers of transfers that we have processed over the last few years. It's very interesting to see that the RIPE NCC ran out and changed the policy to 1/22 per LAR in September 2012. You can see that for the first year since 2012, there were not a lot of transfer requests coming in. This is because many LARs had built up a bit of a surplus over the years, but also organizations started to look at how were they using their IPv4 address space, were they using them efficiently, and they started using up those reserves. About 1 year later, after exhaustion, 2013, we start seeing an increase in transfers, and you can see that the number of transfers processed on a monthly basis now is quite stable. Interesting enough, you can also see that we are transferring quite a bit of prior independent assignments, but also AS numbers and even IPv6 allocations. This is because when an organization transfers their IPv4 resources away, quite often they also transfer away their AS number and their IPv6 allocation. So there is one party taking over everything, and this is reflected in the statistics. Now, if we look at the number of IP addresses transferred, this graph doesn't look really nice and it doesn't really say as much. There's three transfers in here which are ruining my graph. And these happened at the end of 2017. We look at transfers of above, 10 million IP addresses. If we look at those three transfers, they were actually big telecommunication organizations, big telcos in the region that consolidated their memberships. And they did this through the transfer policy, but for this reason, they were not really market transfers because they were still belonging to the same organization. So when we look at it from a logarithmic scale, we can see, we can get a little bit of a better idea about the other transfers. And you can see that transfers are about 500 between the three and around 500 million IP, 500,000 IP addresses that are being transferred every month on average. It's not. You have to shake it? Ah, yes. No, that's someone else. Okay. Try to shake it a bit more. So, what are the transfers based on? What does the transfer policy look like in the RIPE region? There's a very simple policy in place. The requirements are not many, as you can see from here. A transfer must be reflected in the RIPE database, meaning the organizations must contact the RIPE NCC so that we can update all the registration data. Interestingly enough, transfers can be on a permanent but also non-permanent base, meaning an organization can say, I want to transfer those IP addresses to this party for the coming 3 years. And after 3 years, we will revert the transfer back again. And finally, IPv4 addresses, but also 16-bit AS numbers, cannot be retransferred for 24 months. From the moment that the recipient receives them. And again, this is a policy that the community has set in place in order to avoid the flipping of the resources. Yes. Now, here we have a bit of transfer policy history. I will not go through each point, but I think what we can take away from this is that in 2008, things were very relaxed. There wasn't much in place. There was no structure. There were no processes for transfers, also because there wasn't much a need for it. And we can see that over time, the RIPE community has worked a lot on creating policy and on aligning policy as well for the allocation, but also the transfer of resources. And in September 2016, things came together with a single policy document, which manages and handles all the transfers of all the different resources. Now, if we look at what impact the policy has on the transfer market, I really like this graph, and it shows how important the work of the community is. And we can see, for example, in 2012, the final /8 policy was activated. Every LIR could get a /22. Now, from that moment, indeed, we could start seeing that there was a need for transferring resources because organizations could get less IP addresses. And this started growing. In between 2013 and 2014, the need evaluation was removed from policy. That means that organizations did not have to justify anymore the number of IP addresses they were receiving through a transfer. Now, from that moment on, we started seeing transfers skyrocketing. In 2015, a new policy came in, which said that, okay, you know, we want to avoid the flipping of the resources. For this reason, what we do is when you receive a new allocation from the RIPE NCC, you must hold it for 24 months. And also that impacted the number of transfers because they got reduced. So what the community did was to allow transfers and then guide the transfer policies in a way that it was reflecting what the community wanted. And what we see now is that the number of transfers has quite stabilized in our region. Now, if you need IPv4 addresses, where do you go to once you have received the ones from the RIPE NCC? Now, we have created a transfer listing service on our webpage. It's accessible to members. This is mostly to increase transparency because we want our members that have a surplus of resources to be able to contact members that have a need and vice versa, and to do this in a transparent manner. So we have created this listing service. Furthermore, we have a list of brokers listed on our website, IP address brokers, and these are brokers that have agreed to follow the policies set in place by the RIPE community by signing an agreement and to respect the RIPE NCC procedures. Finally, I think that's always important to remember is that the RIPE NCC as an RER is not involved in any financial part of the transaction. We stay really far away from that. So what we do is to facilitate the transfer and make sure that the registry data is accurate and up to date. Now, what we have seen over the last years is an increase also in disputes over IP addresses. IP addresses have become very valuable. And we have even had some organizations that went up to the Supreme Court in a dispute over resources who they were belonging to. So with this, what I want to say is it's always important to keep your data accurate as possible. But also, who do you give the keys to your resources to as an organization? It's very important because we consider these are just numbers, just IP addresses. But they have become very valuable. So also make sure that you give the access to the IP addresses in your organization or to the people that you trust them with it. We have seen an increase in hijacks. We have seen very sophisticated methods being used, fake company registration papers, fake passports, fake websites. We have seen people getting better and better at this. And what we have also noticed is that hijackers often target resources that do not have accurate and up-to-date information. So when I was asked, what would you recommend the LACNIC community and the LACNIC members to do is make sure that you regularly review the data that you have registered in the LACNIC database about your organization, about your IP addresses. And if you see something wrong or something incorrect, talk to LACNIC, work with them on fixing them. Finally, if you are buying IP addresses or if you're selling IP addresses, always make sure that you're in contact with the legitimate holder of those resources. That is very important. And make sure that the people that you're dealing with are actually authorized to handle on behalf of that organization. I think these are two points which we have learned over the years and that are very important. And that was it for me.
Muchas gracias, Andrea. Es muy importante lo que mencionás de mantener actualizados los registros y es bien simple hacerlo a través del portal Milacnic. Vamos a invitar a Nacho Mateo, director comercial de IP Broker, y nos van a comentar un poco cuál es su rol en estas transacciones y su visión de nuestro mercado.
Muchas gracias a todo el mundo por estar aquí y muchas gracias a LACNIC por invitarnos a este evento. Bueno, vamos a intentar explicar cuál es el rol de un broker a la hora de hacer transferencias de dirección IPv4. Nosotros en IP Broker trabajamos con todo tipo de direcciones IP, indistintamente del RIR, indistintamente del país, de todo, o del tipo, ya sea legacy, PA, PI, etc. ¿Vale? Vale. Lo primero que quiero hacer es... lo primero que quiero hacer es que no es objeto de este panel o de esta presentación debatir las políticas de LACNIC, pero para ello ya existen los cauces y conductos adecuados. Sergio ya nos ha explicado la política que en el tercer apartado está. Las opiniones que quiero expresar son personales. Ya sé que aquí hay mucha controversia con esto de las transferencias, por lo tanto, que todo el mundo entienda, por favor, que esta es mi opinión. ¿El rol de un broker cuál es? Pues facilitar las transferencias, encontrar aquellos oferentes de direcciones IP que quieran cederlas a otro ISP y poner todos los mecanismos adecuados para hacerlo. Para ello contamos con las siguientes herramientas. ¿Vale? Como herramientas podemos decir garantías. Aquí lo importante es que todo el mundo quede satisfecho, ya sean los ISPs que quieren obtener sus IPs, y esto suena mal decirlo, pero bueno, cuestan plata las direcciones IP a día de hoy, y que la empresa oferente también reciba su parte. Ojo, si una operación es frustrada, pues evidentemente hay que retornarle la plata, eso es así. Pero insisto, aquí lo primero es generar confianza de que todo el mundo va a quedar satisfecho. Los pasos para garantizar una transferencia es muy sencillo. Lo primero que hay que ver es si hay incumplimientos dentro de la organización o de, ya sea del ISP o del usuario final, lo que en otros RIRs se conocen como LIRS, que todo está en orden y que la transferencia puede ser hecha. Quizás es la parte más importante de una transferencia, porque no siempre se cumplen todas las políticas y entonces LACNIC nos para la transferencia. porque hemos de cumplir las normas, es así de sencillo. ¿De acuerdo? Y luego, aparte de lo que es toda la parte interna de la CNIC, hay que darle la cobertura legal necesaria con los contratos correspondientes, etcétera. Los pasos, como he dicho antes, es facilitar la documentación entre los brokers, facilitar, bueno, entre el broker, el ISP y el oferente, depositar en un fideicomiso internacional, eso es indispensable, para que haya confianza, alguien independiente que salvaguarde el dinero o la plata durante la transferencia, evidentemente siempre y debido a las normas internacionales por transferencia bancaria o wire transfer, ¿vale? Cuando la CNIC ha transferido las direcciones IP, ese es el momento de darle la plata al oferente. Es así de sencillo. Si no, se retorna al que la solicitó. No sé si es necesario que explique lo que es un fideicomiso, pero bueno, si alguno lo necesita saber, es una empresa internacional independiente que reconoce las transferencias de direccionamiento IP y, cuando está finalizada, le entrega el dinero a la parte oferente. El receptor ya tiene sus IPs. En el caso de que el receptor no recibiese sus IPs, se le retornaría la plata. No habría ningún problema. Evolución del mercado de las direcciones IP en Latinoamérica. En estos momentos el mercado es muy cerrado, por una sencilla razón. Las transferencias son muy pocas. En el 2016, 4, en el 2017, 9, en el 2018 vamos por 7 y, en cambio, en otros RIRs pues se hacen las mismas que en un solo año. En un día se hacen las mismas que en un año en la CNIC. Aquí hay que buscar soluciones, porque realmente lo que sí que me estoy dando cuenta es que arriba en las conversaciones todo el mundo pregunta por tener más direcciones IP. Todo el mundo quiere tenerlas. Pues algo tenemos que hacer. A corto plazo, las necesidades de direccionamiento IP de IPv4 de los ISPs de la CNIC sean iguales que de otros RIRs. O sea que, de alguna manera, el número de transferencias ha de crecer, sí o sí. La implementación a nivel global del IPv6 aún va a tardar. O sea, mientras tanto, el IPv4, insisto, es necesario. En mi opinión, la CNIC necesita una política de transferencias inter-RIR que permita las transferencias bidireccionales de IPs entre RIRs. Es mi opinión, pero creo que es absolutamente necesaria. Si no, vamos a cortar el mercado. Y lo único que haremos es que artificialmente subiremos el precio de una dirección IP mientras eso no esté abierto. Volvemos a lo mismo. Mientras el IPv6 no esté a pleno rendimiento, el IPv4 será necesario. Voy a explicar una última cosa, que es la ley de la oferta y la demanda. El direccionamiento IP disponible en la CNIC son 10/8, mientras en toda la Internet aproximadamente en producción tenemos 225/8. ¿Qué quiere decir? Que la CNIC solo dispone de aproximadamente un 4% de las direcciones IP. Pues si no conseguimos meter más direcciones IP en la CNIC, que pueden ser oferentes de ARIN, de RIPE o de IPNIC, estamos fastidiados, vamos a decirlo así. Es necesario. Muchas gracias a todos.
Muchas gracias, Nacho. Como mencionaste al comienzo, digo, la idea no es discutir aquí políticas, pero si tú o alguien de los que están remotos o de los presentes está interesado en presentar una política y llevarla a la lista de discusión, se pueden informar con el staff sobre cuál es el proceso para hacerlo. Muchas gracias. No, de acuerdo. Bueno, invitamos a George Kuo de APNIC para que nos dé una visión desde su región. Gracias.
All right. Good afternoon. I'm George Kuo, Services Director from APNIC. Thanks for the opportunity here to share about transfer information in the APNIC region. So, as you have heard from the previous speaker, so I'm going to focus on a few areas of my talk, basically with the focus on the IPv4 market transfer and walk you through how the transfer policy has involved over the last, ever since was introduced. And hopefully I have some useful information for you that may be interested in the transfer information or are planning for transfer. Hopefully that would help you to have a smoother transfer experience. And lastly, I will walk you through on the transfer activity since day one till now, looking at the statistics, basically. All right, so we are the counterpart of all the regional registries. We look after 56 economies, so there's a lot of economies within the Asia-Pacific region. The region started a discussion about this transfer policy actually dated back to 26th July 2007. That's when the first transfer policy proposal was put forward for discussion. But it did take a little bit long, not until 2011. When the first version of IPv4 transfer policy was implemented, just in time before the IPv4 exhaustion happened in the Asia-Pacific region. So in April 2011, APNIC started delegating the last /8. Then in the same year, so when the IPv4 policy was first introduced in 2010, there wasn't a needs-based requirement, but in 2011, that needs-based was put back on the transfer policy, and in the same year, there was also a policy defining the transfer between IR regions. And up until lately, actually in 2017, there was a ban on the transfer of the last /8, which something that you probably need to be aware of. So I've got a few things here that hopefully that is useful for you. Of course, if you're planning any transfer or those who are interested in transfer need to pay attention to where these address space are coming from. The policy defines that they must be coming out or from the existing member account. The way to check this is to check the who is registration and check the main member list of the APNIC. But if you ever in doubt, do contact APNIC for more information. And of course, like I mentioned, it's a needs-based, so be aware of that. And I think the advantage is just kind of would help you to overcome some overhead so you're not put in the last minute to try to prepare information as a recipient to justify the size of IPv4 you are transferring. And like to mention from the Andrea and John, the inter-IR transfer can happen in and out APNIC region between ARIN and RIPEN-CC. And also one small thing to note, and this is often being asked, is there's a transfer fee involved, and who pays the transfer fee? Now for the transfer happen between parties in APNIC region, the recipient will pay for the transfer fee when it's approved, but for the case that's transferring in or out of APNIC region, the party, the account holder in APNIC region will pay the transfer fee. And I got some URL at the back of these slide that would help you to find out how you calculate the transfer fee. And a little bit more on how APNIC is doing to support the transfer. So those who have received the pre-approval basically is as if you are requesting for IPv4 from APNIC, you provide the justification information, and when that's approved, you're able to list them on APNIC's website as a listing service that's provided by APNIC. And there's also a mailing list to help those that would like to discuss or find out more information about the transfer. Basically, it's a forum for those who wish to talk about IPv4 transfer. And similar to what RipenSys is doing, we also have a broker listing as well. And those brokers also sign agreement with APNIC, basically agree to follow APNIC policy and procedure. And they're all listed on APNIC's website. And just in case that there's a need for you to consult any broker for the transfer. Okay, so let's take a look at the transfer happened since the policy that has been introduced in 2011. There were very little activities happened around the time, 2011 and 12, but beginning from 2013, we're seeing a bit more, but from 2014, there's been a steady growth of the transfer activity between 20, 30, 40, happening a process each month. But a lot of these, or the majority of these, are actually transfer within APNIC's region. We only started to see the transfer between the APNIC and Aran region in 2013, but with the RIPE region, it's only started just 2-3 years ago in 2016. If you look at the total number of address, IPv4 addresses that's involved, up until July this year, that's about 17.8 million V4 that's been transferred into APNIC's region. And like John said, that we've taken a lot of space from Aran region. But small IPv4 space, around 380,000 that have been transferred out of the APNIC region. And like I mentioned, there's a transfer ban on the last /8 that if you only hold it less than 5 years, that you're not allowed to transfer that for the market transfer, and APNIC's last /8 is 103, so just be aware of that. So if you look at the overall transfer trend, starting from when the policy's been introduced, it's quite steady and stable. You see that the orange, the big piece of orange they highlighted there for merger and acquisition, there was just some large /16 transfer between APNIC and the NIRs. But if you look at the blue, which is what we focus on, the market transfer, it's actually quite stable. If you look at the comparison between the transfer within the region and inter area, like I mentioned earlier, the majority of those were actually transferred within the region. And looking at the quantities, number of /24 that's transferred from Aran and RIPE and CC from the other two regions, that's quite a lot of the address space there. If you see the blue, actually are all from Aran region. And if you look at the amount of transfer going out of APNIC region, it's limited, and you only see there were some of them happening since 2015. So basically, that's what I have to share with you. I'm happy to answer more questions later, but if you do have doubt or not able to ask questions, if you are just watching this online, feel free to contact myself or contact APNIC Help Desk. We'll be very happy to assist you with the information you need.
Bueno, muchas gracias, George. Solo un segundito antes de cerrar, Sergio nos va a ayudar a mostrar un gráfico que sumariza un poco las transacciones que mencionaban los otros RIRs, donde se puede ver allí. Sí. Donde se puede ver un poco estos volúmenes de transferencias a nivel global. Mientras tanto, de todos modos, si... Hay un cable. No, en la mesa de aquí. Bueno, este gráfico sumariza un poco lo que venían mencionando John y George en cómo se da ese movimiento de IPs entre las regiones, tanto de Arin hacia Apenic o de Arin hacia Ripe, bueno, y en el otro sentido, Afrinic y LACNIC están fuera. Afrinic recién ahora tiene una política de transferencias dentro de la región, y nosotros hace 2 años y medio tenemos una política dentro de la región. Bien, ahora vamos a abrir el espacio para preguntas, o también si alguien de los que está aquí participó, es una de las 20 organizaciones que participó del proceso de transferencia, si quiere compartir algo, bueno, tenemos este tiempo. ¿Alguna pregunta?
Hola, la pregunta es de Leo Calle de Belice y pregunta si hay un proyecto actualmente en LACNIC para que se empiecen a dar las transferencias entre RIRS.
Bueno, es para mí.
Sí, es para LACNIC. Sí.
No, en este momento no hay ninguna política en discusión que sea para transferencias entre RIRS. Lo que comentaba un poco antes, digo, si alguien está interesado en presentar una propuesta, se puede acercar a cualquier miembro del staff se le puede asesorar o también escribirnos a cualquiera de los contactos y lo podemos orientar sobre cómo participar del programa de desarrollo de políticas.
Buenas tardes, yo soy Alberto Lincla de Argentina, Mar del Plata. Mi pregunta es a todos. A mí me llegaron ofertas de querer alquilarme bloques de IP. Quiero saber si eso pasa comúnmente, si es legal, si es correcto, si se puede hacer en ambos sentidos. Gracias.
Hola, vale. Por lo que yo tengo entendido, sí es legal. Hay un procedimiento establecido a través de LACNIC. LACNIC nos cede las IPs temporalmente y hay un procedimiento para hacer ese tipo de cosas. Sí.
Gracias.
De hecho, en el resto del mundo se hace muchísimo, ¿eh?
En realidad no hay ninguna política que lo prohíba explícitamente, o sea, pero no eso de ceder las LACNIC no cede temporalmente IPs.
So this is John Sweeting with Aaron. So in Aaron, there is no, you can't get space from Aaron in order to lease it to non-customers. There was the policy. Like the customer, in order to get space as an ISP to give your customers had to be connected to you, and you had to be providing them the transit, and that's how you could give them. You didn't lease IPs; you actually just reassigned them to them or reallocated them for their use. It still always belonged to the people that got it directly from Aaron. Didn't belong; it was authorized. They were authorized users. However, there is space that's out there that didn't come from Aaron that people are leasing, and there's websites where they lease it, and some ISPs will route that space as long as they get an LOA from the person that it is registered or the company that it is registered to within the Whois database. That's happened for a long time. Going back, if you were a customer of one ISP and they gave you space to use and you stopped using them and went to another ISP, they would usually give you an LOA to use that space until you could renumber into your new ISP space. So the concept of leasing or routing space for someone with an LOA from the actual organization that is registered within the Whois database does happen and is happening in the Aaron region.
The RER system is a hierarchical system. As regional internet registry, we receive big blocks, or we used to receive big blocks of IPv4 address space. We would allocate a big block to local internet registries. And from there, assignments would be made, meaning more specific blocks would be issued to customers. Now, you can see that as a leasing, as a local internet registry, you give an assignment to a third party. Then when it comes to the routing of those IP addresses, that depends on the agreement that you have with the party that you give the address space to. But in broader term, the leasing, meaning the further delegation of addresses which remain the ownership of the original party, that's a concept that has been in place, let's say, for a very long time, because that's the whole hierarchical structure of the RER system.
Una última apreciación. Si alguien alquila unas direcciones IP, que sepa quién se las alquila y para qué se las alquila. Porque ha habido casos que conozco y no puedo dar nombres de usarlas para spam. Entrar todo el bloque en las listas negras y ese bloque es inutilizable, invendible y nada. ¿De acuerdo?
And just a couple more cautions. If you're leasing space from someone, you're only able to route it because you have an LOA from them. You're paying them a certain fee to be able to do that. Once you're using that, look out for the fees, and also look out for if they get a good offer to actually sell and transfer that space, they can pull it right out from under you. So it is absolutely a temporary space. So if you're just leasing it for a temporary time and you can do without it if they take it away, then maybe it's an option. Myself, I'd stay away.
Good afternoon, Edmundo Cáceres from NIC Mexico. My question is more for people from other registries. If we decided to have a policy for allowing transfer from origin, well, from other regions into origin, would it be required it to be or to have reciprocity allowing transfers from this region to other regions?
In the Aran region, there was a policy that went through that was going to allow Aran to transfer out space to RIRs that didn't have a bi-directional approved transfer. It failed to be approved, but it failed to be approved because there were no RIRs that were available to take advantage of that policy. Whether it would go through or not, that would be something that would be up to the community again, and possibly somebody could put that policy back in if there was another region, such as LACNIC or AFRINIC, that wanted to do a one-way transfer process. However, I think you from my statistics, you should feel pretty comfortable that most of the space is leaving the Aran region. That's where a lot of the space, which it's not a free pool, but it's a cost-free pool, if you would. It's where the inventory, unfortunately, just due to history and all the everything that's happened over the years, that's where the majority of space that's available to be transferred is today.
Yes, let me quote somewhere from the APNIC policy. So it says APNIC will process and record inter RIR IPv4 address transfer only when the counterpart RIR has an inter RIR transfer policy that permits the transfer of address space between APNIC and its own region. So okay. Let me quote the part that's in policy 8.2 of APNIC transfer policy.
In the RAP region, there is no such limitation, so there must not be the reciprocity in the way that we mentioned.
Okay. Thank you.
This is Peter Timmish. This is a question actually for John Sweeting. You touched on it earlier about the cleaning up of the original registry, the legacy space, and about how there are first transfers for mergers and acquisitions, and then the transfer resource. Do you mind kind of walking through all the steps you guys have to do for that? Because it's really quite fascinating, but it's also good for people to understand how much work it takes to bring those original blocks under old name back into the system where they're not under control by any means.
Sure. So we'll have somebody come in and they want to be a source on a market transfer, and they will state, we were issued this by John Postel back in 1989, this /16 network. Unfortunately, the company that we registered it as, it really was never a company. We just gave it a name, and we told John, this is the name of the company we're going to use, and sometimes they would register that company name a couple years later. Sometimes they would never register that company name, but they would use that. They would go to other companies and they'd take that space with them and they'd use it there. So we have to track through all the paperwork that's available, asset purchase agreements, bankruptcies, company dissolution, mergers, acquisitions, everything we can to ensure the pedigree of that person claiming to be the legal successor and the one that has the rights to the
that slot in the who is that that unique number in the database that that they're actually the ones that have that right. Some takes many months. Some take many months, and there's just not enough documentation to make that bridge, and they don't go anywhere. There's lots of good stories I could tell you. There's guys that his space got hijacked. This was told at a Nanog. His space got hijacked. They were trying to provide all this paperwork to Aaron to show that they were the rightful people and they could transfer it. They were trying to transfer it over to somebody in, I believe, must have been Ripe because it was Dubai. But in the end, we found out that there had actually been two companies with the exact same name at that time in the state of California, and that the one that was claiming that the people that they did the all the trace back and all the documentation, they had it all back to the wrong company. So in that, while we were doing all the research for all that, the right company got discovered by the lawyer that was working on this with the team that was trying to get the space, and he went and talked to this person, and of course this person then realized, oh yeah, I am the one that got this space from John Postel. He actually had the email chain from when he got it from John Postel, and that guy was able to show that he was the rightful legal successor, and today he's like transferring out bits and pieces of that slash six. I think it's his retirement plan. So, but there's like that's just one of a million stories. Like that, that there's a lot that goes on with it. So, is that what you're looking for, Peter?
Yeah.
Okay. It's a lot of work. It is a lot of work.
Thank you.
Hola, qué tal? Buenas tardes. Soy Romina Buenaventura. De T-Sparkle, y bueno, preguntaban por las organizaciones que realizaron las transferencias exitosamente. Nosotros somos un caso, como para compartir un poco nuestra experiencia. Nosotros lo hicimos en mayo de 2018 por medio de un broker, IP Trading. Buscamos puntualmente un bloque barra 20. Ellos, digamos, intervinieron en la transacción y en todo momento fuimos asesorados por LACNIC, nos proveyeron los documentos, los acuerdos que había que firmar y en el transcurso de un mes y medio se terminó de hacer toda la transferencia exitosamente. Fue muy buena nuestra experiencia, siempre nos respondieron en tiempo y forma. No sé si alguien tiene alguna consulta para hacernos sobre el tema, pero bueno, esa fue nuestra experiencia, fue muy buena.
Muchas gracias, Romina. ¿Alguien tiene alguna otra consulta?
Sí.
Hola, tenemos preguntas del auditorio que está en streaming. Leo Calle de Belice pregunta ahora si la causa por la que haya tan pocas transferencias en LACNIC se debe a que no existe precisamente la posibilidad de transferir hacia otros RIRs. Bueno, hago una segunda pregunta del streaming. Bradley Fukin y Leo Calle, los dos coinciden en preguntar además, en resumen es, ¿qué está esperando LACNIC para permitir las transferencias entre RIRS?
Hola, voy a responder la segunda pregunta primero. En realidad, LACNIC y su staff no son quienes elaboran las propuestas de políticas. Las propuestas de políticas vienen de la comunidad. Nosotros como staff no presentamos políticas. Por eso mencionaba antes, si Leo o Bradley o cualquier persona de la comunidad está interesado, nosotros podemos apoyar en cómo llevar eso al programa de desarrollo de políticas. Hay una especie de tutores que también pueden apoyar en ese proceso para presentar la política. Nos puede escribir, si quiere, nos escribe a hostmaster@lacnic.net y desde ahí nosotros lo podemos orientar. Para la primera consulta, quizás lo dejo un poco más para Nacho, que ha estado ya viniendo a algunas reuniones nuestras y hablando más. No sabría responder por qué el volumen de transferencias es el que tenemos. O sea, no tenemos un análisis hecho al respecto. Bueno, van a hablar así.
La pregunta sería más bien para Leo y para Bradley, es ¿qué están esperando para proponer una política que permita las transferencias si tanto lo necesitan, ¿no? Y mi sugerencia sería que primero se suscribieran o en cualquier momento que se suscribieran a la lista de correo de desarrollo de políticas del ACNIC, un poco para que conozcan cómo está el tema, pero también que conozcan que ha habido 2 o 3 oportunidades donde la comunidad ha discutido estas políticas y las han rechazado por diferentes razones. Así que el tema no está cerrado, son ustedes, la comunidad, la que puede plantear esas políticas y cuanto antes mejor, porque es una ventana de tiempo el que dura todos estos espacios disponibles de espacio legado que se van a ir a otras regiones. Entonces, si nos vamos a tardar 5 años en definir una política que aproveche ese espacio, va a ser demasiado tarde.
Perdonad que conteste a lo que has dicho, Óscar, y también a la pregunta que ha hecho Leo. Mi opinión, no hay más transferencias porque no hay confianza. Peticiones y solicitudes hay muchas, pero cuando llega el momento de llegar a un acuerdo, no se finaliza. Y a colación de lo que decías antes del Interrir, que se ha negado aquí 2, 3 veces, mi opinión es que el Interrir es necesario porque la CNIC no puede estar de espaldas al mercado. O sea, la comunidad de la CNIC es la única, de momento, porque AFRINIC, por lo que tengo entendido, a lo largo del año que viene lo tendrá, que queda fuera de lo que es las transferencias Interrir. Creo que hay que evolucionar con lo que es la comunidad global, no estar de espaldas a ella. Muchas gracias.
Bueno, muchas gracias a todos. No te veía.
Perdón, aquí entre los moderadores, creo que la primera pregunta no se respondió. La primera pregunta era que a qué se debía o que si la causa de que hubiera tan pocas transferencias en la región del LACNIC se debía a que no hubiera el tráfico entre RIRS o a qué se debía el por qué son tan pocas.
Hello. This question is a very interesting one. Like I mentioned in my presentation, from the moment that we run out of the regular pool of IPv4 addresses in the RIP region, to the moment that we started seeing an increase in transfers, it took more than a year, about 1.5 years. And I do not know if the situation in LACNIC is the same, but what we saw at the beginning was that organizations still had a bit of a surplus of addresses, and they started using those and finishing those. Some organizations started looking at how were they using the IP addresses that they had and tried to make a more efficient use of the IP addresses that they had. And only then, after this phase, they went to the market to get more addresses when needed. So I'm not saying this is what is happening in LACNIC, but this is one of the possible scenarios of why the number of transfers is maybe not that high yet.
I think it's a very simple answer. Unless you have space in the region that people are not using, then they're not going to transfer it. So you got to find space that's not being used by people in order to transfer it. If you have that in your region, you're going to have transfers. We have a lot of that in our region, so there's a lot of transfers. We do like 150 transfers a month. So, you know, you can just compare it to, if everybody in the region today, in the LACNIC region, if they're all using their IPs, then they're not going to transfer it to somebody else. That's, I think, the simple answer to it.
I'm just referring to the activities in APNIC region. I mentioned earlier the policy was introduced back in 2011, and in the first 2-3 years, there was very little activities of transfer as well, and we only started to see the transfer increasing from 2014. And I'm not drawing any conclusion, but I'm just, you know, looking back at the stats and what happened since the policy's been introduced.
Yeah, I'll just add a little bit more. So in the Aran region, transfers really took off after the free pool run out, which was September 2015, I believe, off the top of my head. And the transfer policy evolved through time. It took quite a lot to get the inter-RIR transfer because it was there was a lot of, no, these are our addresses. They're in our region. We don't want them going out anywhere. But eventually, more of the people were of the fact that they realized that just due to circumstances, there was this large surplus. The legacy space was in the Aran region, and it was only fair to open that up to the other RIRs. So that policy we have today, that's the best that the community could hammer out between themselves, and so that's what we have. Like I said, they tried to do the one-way transfers out of the region. There was a lot of people that believed that we should do that, but there were enough people that didn't believe we should do that. They want the reciprocity. I hate that word. So, you know, Andrew, you're sitting back there. You know a little bit about the history of that, but that's about how it went. It went, and the final thing was it got voted down because there wasn't anybody that could use it anyway. So that was the final reason for it.
My name is Andrew Dole. I'm on the Aran Advisory Council. So just a few notes about the policy of the reciprocity policy. Am I too close? Is that the problem? So we considered a policy which would only allow one-way transfers, and this would have affected LACNIC and AFRINIC if they decided to... Should I go this way or what? So we considered that policy, and there was support for it, assuming that other regions would also adopt it. But what the community in the Aran region noted was that neither LACNIC nor AFRINIC were in the process of passing one of those policies, so the community did not feel the need at that time to adopt a one-way transfer policy. I think if either LACNIC or AFRINIC did adopt a one-way transfer policy, then the Aran region would again consider it and discuss whether it was appropriate at that time.
Thank you. Bueno, ahora sí. ¿Hay alguna otra consulta? Bueno, me gustaría agradecer a todos los panelistas por su tiempo y a ustedes los participantes que están aquí, los que están remotos. Quedamos disponibles para cualquier consulta, como mencioné, por hostmaster@lacnic.net o transferencias@lacnic.net. Cualquiera de las dos direcciones de correo llegan a nosotros en servicio de registro. Bueno, muchas gracias por su tiempo.